So I'm so sorry that my preparation was very bad. So today, this is one of our the female doctors at our university. So we have some association in the hospital. So how to build a pipeline in the future neurosurgeons? So just it's a lack of time. So maybe just you can see the slides. So this is what I'm doing every day. So go to the meeting and read the textbook and the preparation of the surgery and also the so this is education. So I think as a neurosurgeon, it's a physical hard work and it's emotionally hard work. So both you can control. I think every day just you can stable the condition. That is very important. And five qualities to be an excellent neurosurgeon. I'm not focused on the neurosurgeon, but the good doctors. So honesty, willing to learn the study, and how to handle the stress and the ability to problem solve. Motivation. Keep the motivation is very important. The quality of the great neurosurgeon has so many factors. So the organization and also the team player and communication skills is another very important thing because teamwork right now. So and also the critical thinking, always we face of the critical aspect. So ability control the emotion already I talked. And also the research for neurosurgical education. So those things that, and also that we need the overall training, the culture with faculty mentorship and the provision of the time and the resources for research activities. So that you should keep the research mind, not only the daily clinical work because it's very hard, so exhausted every day. So but maybe even a 10 or 15 minutes every day. So just you can think about the your research from the clinical or basic laboratory. And so adequate time for personal development and the challenge at work and the work-life balance is another very important things. And so I think promote awareness that equality of the sexes. So this is you do not need to fight with another gender. So just you can have a confidence and also you can find what you want to do in a future career. So I think that is very important and also the find the good mentor. That's another important, I think. And promote female leadership in the in academic positions. So this is one a neurosurgical case, but I don't have maybe enough time. Just this is a 3D CT. So many image is coming up, and so this is just video. So the surgical skill is as a surgeon is very important. This is I'm peeling out of the STA superficial temporal artery, and you should see the video the repeatedly. This is just inside of the dura, and this is the brain surface and the cut arachnoid membrane. So this is the sylvian fissure. This is the right side. Here is the frontal lobe, and this is the temporal lobe. And also preoperative image, amyloid image is the recent preoperative image is very, very beautiful and very close to the real one. And this is a superficial temporal artery which I harvested. And the anatomy is the pressure is thrombus, so then we try to abandon the keep the one vessels, then superficial temporal artery and the middle cerebral artery is low flow bypass was put. So this anastomosis technique, maybe you can practice every day, every night. You can do it at home, I think. So this is it's a 40 milliliter per minutes increase of the blood flow. Okay. Then here is an osmosis place. Then we excise, we cut the branch one here. And here is STMC fibers here. And the temporary clipping. And already you can see that this branch is already the totally occluded with the atherosclerotic change. So yellow part is a very severe atherosclerotic change, and also the patient has a thrombus inside. Patient came to us with infarction, left hemiparesis, and we placed a clip with multi clips. So and that this is the inside of the aneurysm. It's already the some part is thrombolized. So the strategy is very important, and this is pathology, and here is so many the thickenings of the wall, and all. So this is I would recommend that everybody to have a hybrid neurosurgeon if you want to become a neurosurgeon, because you should have mind the both ability. This is a direct surgery, open surgery, and then this is the endovascular surgery, which is the best option for the for your the patient. You should think about. And this is so many devices. Of course, already you know so many devices day and night is coming up. So. And also my interest was wall, aneurysm wall property. And before surgery, we do the CFD, then we can pick up the very the weak point of the aneurysm, which will be a chance of the premature rupture, that we can weak point detection with the CFD. So this is kind of the, some another field that we can share, and so this is a CFD image 4 pattern. So this part is can be the very thin that we can expect before surgery. So this is a during surgery picture, and this part is very thin. It is much. So our university is consists of 4 university. So a part of my life is every day is my active working days since the first day, and challenging and the various of the operating the procedures, complex disease, and advanced, the world's improving the patient quality of life. So this is maybe when I was young, so this is my everyday wish. And my philosophy career, the good collaboration with other organizations and societies, and contribution of the opportunity to the young blood neurosurgeons, update knowledge and the surgical techniques, and support YNS and women neurosurgery to improve their current and the future works, helping to improve the patient outcome, especially the low income countries. So volunteer the work. Not only the doctors, we teach or we support of the nurses. This time is the nurse from India, and also so that this is my mentor, the two big mentors, and this is my colleagues, and this is the colleagues women neurosurgery, and so this is when I visited India. So because, she is. She is the founder of the Asian lady neurosurgeon. She was the first. She was the first lady neurosurgeon in Asia. Already, she passed away 2 years back. So I think India is a very conservative country. It's still very conservative, but I think that it's a bit changing now in the neurosurgical field in India. So this is some communication and education course. This is when I've been to the Cambodia. So many young students, the hands-on workshop. And this is just we can teach them with we can read the angiogram. Of course, the party is another very important factor. And also, this is when I visited Russia and Moscow. So the exchange of the knowledge and the culture, whatever, I think communication with other community or society is very important. And so many differences. But I think exchange is the treasure for yourself, I think. And this is inner Mongolia. Of course, you know the Mongolia, but this is just inner side of the Mongolia, the Chinese, China. And also this is there when I visited Africa, Zimbabwe. So the Africa is totally different from our lifestyle, but I think they work very hard. And also we demonstrated the several good typical the surgery, the picking or the tumor resection, and also the doctor, the fully had a red cap from America, is explaining to the young doctors. And also that we teach them the how to use, handle the microscope, and also the young doctors exchange a forum. And so this is Uzbekistan, Central Asia. So still Central Asia needs some help. So I think all exchanges are very important. And this is Uzbekistan when I visit them, their country, exchange of the MOU. And we had a very good conference and followed by the demonstration of the surgery. And also during the pandemic era at that time, so the travel restriction and also the virtual reality simulator and such kind of the web conference among the young doctors and also the female neurosurgeon or some other with the countries. Even the pandemic era, that we can have the lots of conference. Of course, maybe in a few months is that we can see each other in person. So this is alumni. So the Fujita alumni, so many doctors came to us, almost 300 now, including nurses. And also this is a webinar, the Women Neurosurgery. And also we established the Asian Journal of the Neurosurgery. And this is some and also this is Asian Medical Student Resident Society of the Neurosurgery. So when I visit Nepal, so all medical students who want to become a neurosurgeon, yes, we exchange the opinion, and they ask us so many questions.
I would like to thank Chair and his team.
And your life starts them from the medical the student. I think it's very, very good time for all of you to think what I should become, how nice of the doctor I can be, how I can save the patient life. I have some another responsibility of the minimally invasive. The neurosurgery. This means if you have some interest of the minimal invasive, just let me know. Maybe we can have some web conference in between your Dundee Society in the very near future. So we, International Society of Minimal Invasive Neurosurgery, we foundation was done in Florence in 2010. And also, finally, I think before the new pre or to be a neurosurgeon, what is the most important thing is how the human being you can be. So deepening the self-awareness and becoming a better influencer and the leading with the honesty and improving a coaching the skills of developing the emotional intelligence. The seven escalation of the which neurosurgeons must be aware. There's so many things, financial, no time to read everything, but and also the 10 things patients should look for in the neurosurgeon. So the last five is very important. So the most important thing is the honesty to you and to the patient. And he is Henry Marsh from England. So he is the father of the ethical dilemma issue and provides the concept of the do no harm in such case of a hopeless care in neurosurgery. And another the guy from Sydney, he saved the life of the 24 years patient with a brain tumor, given 6 weeks to live. But after that, he did a surgery, days later, he was back at the piano. So we cannot never give up. So my work's achievement is increasing the number of the patient in complex disease in the hospital and improving the treatment outcome using a new technology devices and a good response for the volunteer society's network. And successfully organized several international conferences for academic topics on site and or webinar, increasing the number of the attendee awareness and the women neurosurgery on the society. Longevity and the sustainability of the neurosurgery is providing education to the next generation. So this is just my video. So we are planning to have a young neurosurgeon, the students, women neurosurgery, World Wellness Congress, which will be held in May 6 to 8. So we can invite all of you because the Wellness or Student Award we are planning. So the deadline of the submission is April 22nd. So medical student session and the women in neurosurgery session and also the alumni session. So maybe you can submit your the papers, whatever you want. And also those mentor is an important thing when you do the carry out in the future. So this is a wellness award session. So don't forget the submission deadline. So I think it's a challenge. The harder the course, the more rewarding the triumph. Thank you for your attention. Can you hear?
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Kato, for your kindly words and for all your advices that you gave us. We really appreciate it. And I really admire you, all of your work, because since the pandemic started, like 2020, I was entering more and more webinars and I got the opportunity to hear from you in many of them. And you are really an inspiration for all of us. And I have been talking about you to the female students here, and they also admire all your work and all the road you had in medicine. Thank you, doctor. Thank you for being here and for all your presentation. We are looking forward to meet you in person.
Yes, So thank you so much for your time. I'm so sorry because at the maybe 20 minutes, some of my travel. And maybe in the future, I think I want to have a summer webinar with a Bolivian lady student. So just I can contact you. Okay.
Yeah, of course. Thank you, doctor. Looking forward to that. Thank you so much
Thank you very much. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you, doctor.
Okay. Bye. Thank you.
Well, it's an honor to present Professor Guadalux. She is a researcher and a medical illustrator, graduated from medical school with a second honor degree awarded by the Medical Council of Thailand, specialized in neurosurgical surgery, Medical Council of Thailand, made the neurovascular training program from Royal College of Thailand Neurosurgery, and actually is a neurosurgeon in Chiang Mai Neurosurgical Hospital in Thailand. Please, doctor, enjoy.
Yeah, so she was here right now and we're going to wait. She's joined already.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, doctor.
Okay.
Good morning.
Morning.
Thank you the effort. So Dr. Warlux and Dr. Kato, they are 13 hours ahead of us and we really appreciate their effort for being here.
Okay, can you see my slide?
Yes, doctor, perfectly.
Okay, so Mikhail Leitner was talking after the greatest Dr. Kato, which is really great and a great mentor to all the women all around the world already. But for me, so I'm gonna talk about it in the different parts. I mean, younger generations of working as the woman neurosurgeons in my side. And okay, so first of all, I would like to say greetings to all of you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, especially to all the Bolivian Medical Student Associations. I am so happy and honored to give a presentation today talking about my pathway and relevance of women in specialties of neurosurgery in my perspective. Today, I would like to share my point of view, what I do and how I do it, and I always open the floor for discussions and questions. But many of you ask, who am I? Yes, because I'm just young girls, neurosurgeons. My name is Dr. Warlux Phu Sung Nern. I am the neurovascular surgeon and neurointerventions from Thailand. My current position is the head of the neurosurgical unit, Chiang Mai Neurological Hospital. My subspecialty is neurovascular and interventionist. I also specialize in spine and skull-based surgeries. In 2019, I won the fellowships in Hyogo College in Medicine, Japan. I be with Professor Shinichi Yoshimura. I study about neuroendovascular treatment. That was a great experience at that time. So this is my picture. For the first picture, this one, I got my first diploma certificate in medicine. As you see that, I still got a big smile. Second picture is I got my second degree, about a higher diploma certificate for clinical science and medicine. A smile got a little bit smaller. And the third picture is I got my neurosurgical diploma certificate. And the recent one is neurovascular surgeons from Royal College of Thai Neurosurgeons. Yeah. Working as woman neurosurgeon is almost full-time jobs every day. Even you have your own schedule times of working, but taking care of the patients is mandatory and routines, like morning ward routing to do the operations, outpatient clinic, evening ward routings, or on-call is your duties. But I think the training, when you get into the training, it will make you get stronger and you will get used to it by times. And you will find the most flexible ways to fit it for your lifestyle. So as I have to say that working and trainings will bring the opportunities to life. You will meet a lot of new place, new mentors, staff, and friends, and more like abilities to achieve your goals. And this is all I have, and that is what many people knows about me as a doctor parts, and then I also do other roles besides that. I also the medical illustrators. I illustrate for many medical textbooks and international journals. I have designed personal presentations for Illustrical TV and do the local designs. I am also international editorial boss of Asian Journals of Arts and Cultures. So here's some of my illustrations that I have made for international publications. This is one is for the Movement Neurosurgeons from Asia and Australasia that just published last year. And many more. This is my other role, like besides to be a neurosurgeon. So it's all like busy, working as a doctor, working as like neurosurgeons, but it's okay. I mean, I am here today to try to tell you that women can do anything. And it's work out really good, you know, if you know how to balance it very well. And I love what I am doing. So I live in Thailand. So Thailand is located in the southeast of Asia. The capital city is Bangkok. It's one of the crowded and modern capital cities. It has the longest capital city names in the world. My hometown sits in the north of Thailand. It is called Chiang Mai. Chiang Mai is the old capital city of Thailand. We are for famous tourist attractions. We have mountain views, rainforest, old city architectures, low cost of living, and of course, like famous street food. Our major religions here is Buddhism. We have a lot of temples and towns, and our peoples are friendly and peaceful. If you want to come in here and visit or travel here, you can visit me. But before I go into talk about why and how, why I have to choose neurosurgery, I will tell you about my previous time first. None of my family members or relatives have associated with the healthcare professions, except my mom. She's owned the lacquerwares and crafting factories. My dad, he's engineering. And I am half Chinese and Thai. My mom used to tell me that her belief, she was told by her ancestor that they believe that woman duties is only take care of the family members and only have kids. And education is not that important. But my mom, she believed it differently. She really good at a full-time mom. She supported all of me and my younger sister. She worked really hard. She does top student in her class. So I think that she passed her strength and her wishful through me. So I think that for the family support system is very important. So how do I get into this path? How do I know this is the right way or right track for me? I was asked many times. So I think that three factors that helped me to choose this path is you have to know me, know you, and know them. What does that mean? Know me means that you have to know what is you like, your personalities, your weak point, your strengths, and your lifestyle. For example, my personalities, I love challenge, creativities, I can do hard work, delicate. I like paperwork as well as the hand skill, like surgery case. It's all compromise. And I know my weak point is I am left-handed girl and I'm a little bit clumsy, but don't take me the wrong way. I do not take the weak point as the obstacles or an excuse to not choosing the path that I want to be, but think in the optimistic way that the weak point is the motivations that you will know what you can improve your skill. And know you mean if you have your goals and or maybe it's not that clear, but it's upskills, but maybe you have to prepare it now. So it means that you have to know what is the minimum or maximum requirement. But it's not only that, you have to prepare for the accessories too. What does it mean? For example, if you want to be a neurosurgeon, of course that the main requirement is like, okay, a little good GPA, good behave, like you show your that how much you sacrifice and show your abilities, how well you cope with the situations. And then you will give a good recommendations and you show your interest. And what it means by accessory, for example, when they get into the interviews to be the surgical residents, when they see like, okay, I match my main requirement, they do not ask about the details about my requirements anymore. They ask me about something else. So you have to show what is your strength in which it's related to the ability that you want to show them. It's like I told him that I am the piano teacher to the kids, so I can sit with the kids and then I be patient and like listens to them what they want and be patient to talk to tell them to teach them step by step. And I also do painting, so it represents like my I can do that delicate work. And my favorite boxing, my favorite job, my favorite exercise is boxing and judo class, so it's show my strength. And know them, it means that all these factors that you have to be compromised by your family's time. So I want to emphasize to you that work-life balance to be a woman is very important. For example, okay, you can work hard, but it should that work should provide you to have the spare time to spend with your families and for yourself too. So give you some free time and you for your own relaxations, and should give you a reasonable financials and good support, family system and coworker is very important. So I got into the Faculty of Medicine at last, and the first clinical years, the student only study about the basic science and clinical subjects. And after that, for the 4 to 6 year, we practice in the real patients. One of my favorite subjects is anatomy class and neuroanatomy. I like to do the sketch and drawing while I'm studying. So I think that I make my decisions of my study depend on the most specialties that flexible and fit with my lifestyle. So I think that when you're training in the clinical years, it's a good time for you to collect all the information and then you can know what is the specialty that fit with your lifestyle. But unfortunately, I do not have any experience attending the neurosurgical case before. But actually, instead, I was told by many of the guys seniors at that time that neurosurgery is the mysterious and hardworking field. It's like the forbidden forest that you can only see from the outside. It's a misty and dusty place, and it scares you that you should not go in there. But I should at it last. And why? I choose to study neurosurgery because I think that it's my fit with my lifestyle, because I like challenging. So neurosurgeon is hardworking, require high skill. It's clean fields, very delicate, and especially you can see it while you operate. Even it's hard, and you know that in Thailand, neurosurgeon is the most like difficult board that you can pass the board exam. So, and I do not find obstacles or difficulties between men and women to work in these fields, so I apply for it. But hold on, I don't know if how many of you have experienced the interview part. So if you prepare to apply for that, you might have to prepare for some of the specific questions for the woman doctor that we might be asked. For example, like, when will you plan to have kids? When will you get married? How long will you live for maternities? How well can you tolerate these traits? Or what is your boyfriend, husband doing? Are there healthcare professions? I have to tell you that some of the interview might ask you this, but just answer them like, what is your thinking or what is true? But you have to tell them what is your plan of your solutions too. And I have to tell you that for this thing is the nature of humans. It should not be an included of women to working as a surgeon. So any difficulties or challenges that I might find along the way. Another issue that is very important is difficulty and challenge of being a woman in neurosurgical fields. But today I will tell you my top 6 of everyday challenge. The first one is I often mistaken by the patients to or other healthcare professions or being someone else. This is the very common like problem for me. I was mistaken a lot by the patient for being someone else. Even I am there with the dress codes. I will give you examples. Like one time I went to see my patients in the ER room. I would ask to give an advice to their families and they walk past me by and looking for a doctor. So I go and introduce myself and told them all the information, and they still keep a little doubt on me, but still let me do the operations anyway. And other times, I am in charge and take care of one of the patients who have thoracic hemorrhage. I have told him and explained all the management plans. They seem to understand, but another day, I found that they post on the Twitter that they want some other instead. But at the end, the member of the Twitter recommend me instead, so they come back and say sorry. But I do not angry. And another times, while I'm doing my craniectomy clot removal, one of the retired doctor neurosurgeons who retired came into the OR room and tell me that their relative members call me and want him to take care of this kid instead. So he have already told him that I am experienced and qualified to do this case, but they say that because I am look too young to be neurosurgeon. So these are the examples of mistaken by the patients that I face. But you know, like I try, I do not like angry with these patients, but instead that I try to fix that by like, okay, my, how do I look, my appearance. But I will tell you now that times will tell and it's gonna be getting better by times. Second thing is self-doubt or fear of being discovered as an intellectual fraud. Right after that, I am a doctor. I do not hesitate to further my specialties as neurosurgeons. I start my career at a very young age. Of course, I have some self-doubt or fear that I might not doing well in the thing that I do. Even I know I can do it, but they have some hesitations or overthinking. So this is make me have low self-esteem. But the situation is worse on the first year after I graduated, because I still have lack of experience and I just changed my working environment, but it's getting better by time. So now today I found myself more comfortable with these situations. The third one is I am left-handed, totally left. There's no surgical instrument that provide for the left surgeons while I'm training all women when I am working now. At the beginning, I feel really embarrassed when I was asked to cut the suture and I cannot cut it with the normal scissor that they gave me. Or the directions of your suture, it will be total different from the other surgeons because you are left-handed. Left-handed surgeons have to struggle a lot, not only to improve their own skills to do it operations, we have to try to be the both hand surgeons, but you have to deal with your assistant and obstruct and scrub nurse. I found this obstacle as a motivation to keep me to keep practice on my surgical hand skill more than normal people. So I practice on my surgical skill like more, like after I finish my case, so I practice more in the lab case. So it's make me to make sure like for every move, every cut or every instrument, it have to be precise and delicate. And you know, like it still have some belief that women are the weaker. When I am the residents, I always feel that women was treated different from men. We will shoot to assess the case by the type of the operations because of the ideas that women are weaker. And they think that we are not too strong to carry the heavy instruments or do the hammering or drilling stuff. But you can prove to them that the abilities to do the surgery good is not about the strength or how strong you are, but it depends on the your experience and how and the skill that you have. And of course, like sexual harassment. But it's not really happened to me, but I was told by other women colleagues that some that will have the sexual harassment. But I want to tell you now that if this if this thing happened to you, you should tell them directly about that misbehave since the first time. So it's just like a warning sign and just tell them to respect you. And the last thing is taking maternal leave. I do not have, I have a family, but I do not have kids yet, but I have to take that. Is an issue because it's gonna be like my issue in the future. What I plan to do is I'm going to tell them that it's a very big duties for the woman. It's a great thing that our duties to have a kids and a family. And I encourage every woman that we can do both things very well. So what is my main motivations to pursue these specialties in particular? As I told you that I like to do the challenge stuff, I do not believe that there is a barrier or difference between men and women in any other fields, except some, like we have a different hormone or physical appearance, but these things are uncontrollable factors. So my motivations to pursue me in this specialty of neurosurgery is after I know that this is the most like, difficult board exams and only few residents can pass its years. So it gave me like motivation that, okay, I have to pass it to prove myself that women can do it. So in Thailand, neurosurgery, we have 5-year trainings. The student have to pass the basic science on the second years, and you can take the board exam since you only in the third year. So which means that if you not pass on the third year, you can keep continue take the test until you pass it. And you still have to do the paper exams, oral exams, and get collection experience, and have to do the elective program. So as you see that, besides that, you have to handle your time management very well. You have to do routines, what routing, like morning, evening, scan round, or case conference. You have to keep improving your surgical skill for your own experience, your practicing, and your learning curve. And for your knowledge, you learning for other exams, for updates knowledge. In which this thing is 24 hour. So you should know how to manage it. So work-life balance is very important. And other thing is, if you become a neurosurgeon, you realize that miracle happen in real life. For example, like in acute hydrocephalus case that come with coma, you just put a small hole and you can make the patients like wake up alive and bring them to give a happiness to their families again. Or in the traumatic brain injuries, trauma in the young people, even they come in a very coma state, but they will recover very well after the 3 or 6 months and will bring the happiness to their families again. Okay, so for take home message to me today from me is don't be afraid to show a different part than other. And I think we are lucky enough to be different and never change. And emphasize again that work-life balance is very important. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rolux, for your beautiful presentation and all the advices that you gave us. It is a really huge honor to have you here from the other part of our world. So we really appreciate also your efforts. So I think that your experience, that the surgeries that you had to deal with, for example, the one that you told us where there was another neurosurgeon that the family wanted to be in charge of their son's surgery. I think it's pretty difficult, but maybe there's something about that that has to do with us getting better and to not to have like a low expectation that we have to be better and they will recognize it sooner or later. So I think that. Thank you, yeah. Doctor. So maybe Mariana, she wants to say something. Please go ahead.
Yeah, well, good morning, doctor. I just wanted to tell you that I relate a lot to your experience in your presentation. Being another young woman, I feel like it's a lot closer, and our countries are also quite similar, especially with things that you mentioned later on with maternity. I feel like a lot of the women in surgery in general, not just neurosurgery here, often tell you, yeah, you should consider what you want to do with your life. And it is a big point to consider once that you're giving so many years of your life for everything. And I really related to that. Also the imposter syndrome that I feel like everyone gets. I feel that someone who already has their life together like you is also has it is a bit more reassuring, like, okay, it's fine to have it.
Yes. I think the most irritating things that even I think it's take me like 14 or 15 to keep studying all this stuff, but I mean, I still have this face young. And the most irritating thing is that two things is, one thing is when I got interviewed, they still keep asking me the questions about like when you're going to have kids. And they always, the guy, doctor always remind me of that. You have to consider, you have to tell me earlier, when are you planning to have kids? In which I think for me, it's really irritate. Like what does it have to do with the work? I mean, come on. Like, okay, I can be pregnant and go to work. It's about me, but okay, maybe I will leave like just a little bit, but I gonna tell my colleagues to like, you know, take turns on me. But I mean, I don't know in your country or in other part of the world, these questions like they keep to ask when interview or not. I don't know, maybe many people take in a different way, but it's because I study a lot and then I apply to many hospitals, I mean, for my private. So I have to tell you that this is the most irritating thing and they keep asking me all the time. Yes, and it's also okay. One time, the last time that I experienced, they give an issue for me and they told me that if I'm pregnant, they might hire some other doctors, I mean, guy doctor instead of me too. So I say that, oh no, why you have to do that? I mean, you know, I can do it. And I don't think it's a big issue. Yeah. You can share experience if you feel that.
Yeah, yeah. It's quite similar here as well. Similar. I'm not in the interview portion now, but a lot of doctors tell you, yeah, please consider if you're getting married, if you're going to have children. And it's very invasive, you know, like it's your life. Yes.
Yes, it's very invasive. About mistakes by the patients too, like the situations that I face are the most that I think that I make me a little bit sad is they ask my colleague who is the same age as me instead because they consider that he's only have a guy face. So, but now I just, but I get used to that already and I'm not angry, but as you say that it will be improved by times. And the more often that the patients see us and how well that we do it, so they will recognize us like gradually.
Yeah, I really agree with both of you. And as Mariana was saying, when we are in the hospital with our teammates, with our male teammates, we are in the same grade, we are wearing the same clothes, we have our white coats, and the patient goes there and tells, hey, doctor. And for me, hey, lady. So it's pretty much the same. And also the doctors, they are like, we're still students, but they tell, if you want to pursue like a surgical career, you have to not have kids. And if you have them, you can either be a mother or you can either be a surgeon. Or if you are going to have kids, you will have to leave the hospital, something like that. So those are some pretty discouraging words, but listening to the experience of a person that is already in the field and not a doctor, I think it really is like a huge experience for us. So thank you, doctor, for sharing all of your experiences. And also like the exams that you gave for your boards. Here in Bolivia, it's like one general test for all the specialties, and like the higher grades, they can get to apply to another programs or like that. But here in Cochabamba, we don't have a neurosurgeon residency. It's only in some other departments like the La Paz, like Santa Cruz, but not in Cochabamba yet. But we have some really good female also neurosurgeons and some also very good teachers. So we are going like to fight on this, and we really appreciate you for your words, for your time, and for telling us all the advices that you gave us. Thank you, doctor.
I do something about the medical illustration. If you need my associations or my work, you can contact me anytime. Yeah.
Yeah, I really admire your work. We have been following you on your social media, on LinkedIn and also in Facebook, and all your works that are published on papers. I think it's great that you can get to like combine all of your passions, like neurosurgery and art, and you have the ability to do it. And I think it's great. Thank you, Doctor. I think Mariana wanted to say something.
Yeah, I wanted to say that I saw your illustrations on Instagram as well, and I thought they were really cool. I also saw the pictures of your cat, Meagle. So I also think those were really well done. It's interesting, you know, because you think of doctors who already have their life together as so separate than you. And then, you know, because you're so young and because you're, it's like, you know, because we relate so much to you, it just feels like, oh yeah, you're a regular person, you know, even if you do like really amazing things.
But I'm not that young, you know. I almost 40. I mean, yeah, but I'm not that young. That's my point.
The thing is, like, you know, it feels a lot closer just because, for example, Dr. Kato, even though she's also a doctor, it just feels a little bit more separate, maybe because our countries are so different.
Yeah, also like a huge background, so it was a really good opportunity to meet both of you. And here we have Justine. She's a student from Argentina. I don't know, maybe she wants to say something. She's the president of Dundee Argentina. Otherwise, thank you, Doctor. We can end the meeting now.
Hello, everyone.
Hi, Justine. Go ahead, please.
Hi, Justine.
Oh, I'm sorry. My internet is very poor today, so I'm sorry for the delay. It's a pleasure to have all of you here, and I'm so thankful to Dundee Club at Bolivia and Nicole to invite us to participate with this. Thank you, Dr. G, for your presentation.
Yeah, you're welcome. Okay, I feel that I love to trans women residents. I mean, I love to train women residents, and every time that I have the younger year, I really happy to have them, and I love to train them like younger sister, like get dressed together and like you can tell me anything, small or little things. I mean, I love to trans and to teach the women residents more than guys. Yeah, I have guys too, but yeah. So if you have the younger residents, I think that like to treat them like a friends, girl group or anything, like a supporting system, you know.
Yeah, because for example, in the club we have students from first, second, third year, and I am in fifth year. So when I was in first year, I was interested in neuroanatomy, and I was just entering this whole world, and I had no one to guide me, and I had no one to show me the way or like telling me, hey, go in this webinar or like that, because it was before the pandemic and there wasn't this so many opportunities that we have now. So I think that having like this support system, having this club, it is like a way for us to share this experience and to guide the students that are coming along. And yeah, we are pretty, pretty emotional to have them here.
Anytime you can, any of my help. I mean, if I can help.
Thank you, Dr. Of course, we'll be in touch. Yeah, and let me tell you, we are organizing like an in-person Congress. It is going to take place on December. So we would love to have you here. You will definitely receive our invitation, and we look forward to meeting you in person.
Okay, sure.
Love it. Will be great.
Meet you guys.
Thank you, Doctor.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Doctor. Goodbye.
Thank you, everyone. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Justine. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much, Nicole.
So thank you everyone for being here tonight. We are going to end this meeting now and you will be receiving the updates on our next events. Thank you, Mariana. Thank you, Najeli, for being here and of course to all of our attendees. Thank you everyone and see you later. Please take care.